Hello dear students and a very good morning to all of you. Today again I am back here with the history part of the social science classes for class 8 and I am going to provide you the third part of the chapter number 8, that is colonial education and its impact. Okay, so as I have already provided you the two parts of this video and I hope all of you have watched it and then only you are moving towards the third part. Okay. So basically in the second part also, we have learned about the Charter Act, okay, the English Education Act. We have learned about the Woods Dispatch and other commissions that were established in the field of the development of the Indian education in India, okay. In this part, we will basically focus, one topic was left, I just forgot to explain you in that part. So that I'm going to conclude it here, and today we are going to learn about the national education. That means when Britishers were introducing Western education in India, at that time, what was the mindset of the Indian educationist, okay? They have accepted the Western education or they have opposed it. About this only we are going to learn in this part, okay? So here I want to explain you about the Christian missionaries or the Christian religion that came to India. All of you are knowing that the Britishers belong to Christian religion, okay? So when Britishers came to India, like we have learned about the Jainism and the Buddhism, that how Gautam Buddha and Lord Mahavira and their proponents, their students, worked in the field to expand or to the religion or to spread the religion all over the world. Basically, Christian missionaries were the people. First of all, Christian missionaries came to India. Now, obviously, the question will arise in your mind that who were the Christian missionaries? So, students, Christian missionaries were basically the people, okay? Those who came to India for the purpose of spreading Christianity, as well as they came to India to convince more and more people to adopt Christian religion, okay? So, for this motto only, Christian missionaries came to India for the purpose of spreading their Christian religion as well as for convincing more and more Indian people for adopting the Christian religion. Okay, and somehow for some of the people of India have also accepted Christianity. Okay, they just turned their religion from Hindu or Muslim to Christianity. Okay, so basically Christian missionaries were on a mission, okay, to spread their religion in India. But since British officers were totally focusing on the practical education, Christian missionaries, those who came to India, were opposed to this mindset of the British officers to propagate practical education in India. Okay, so basically the Christian missionaries strongly criticized practical education in India. Okay, they criticized that India do not require any practical education. Now it is quite obvious that the question will arise in your mind that why Christian missionaries were not in favor of moral education, since they also belong to Britain only, they were also the Britishers only, then why they were not in favor of the other Britishers to provide practical education. So students, basically the Christian missionaries believe that first of all, we have to improve the moral character of the Indians, okay? Christian missionaries believe that this time Indian requires moral education, and that moral education can only be provided to them with the help of Christian education, okay? So they wanted to improve the morality in Indians, and for that purpose only they said that this time Indian required moral character or moral education in comparison to the practical education, okay? But since British East India Company was spreading at that time in India and expanding itself, if someone told you, if you are Hindu, Muslim or Christian, you belongs to any religion, if someone told you to change your religion, I don't think so that any one of us are ready to change our religion, okay? If someone try to change our customs, our religion, our culture, so it is quite obvious that it will hurt our sentiments, okay? British officers were also thinking the same, that like this, if Christian missionaries will started convincing people for the purpose of changing the religion to Christianity, as well as if they will try to spread a new religion in India, it is quite obvious that the people of India do not like it, okay? And okay, they are not going to like it and it will hurt their sentiments. So those British officers were not ready for this kind of oppose from the Indians. Okay, that is why before 1813, the Charter Act of 1813 came to India, okay? And before the introduction of the Charter Act, English East India Company opposed to missionaries' activities, okay? English East India Company do not allow any missionaries' activities. That means they banned the arrival of Christian missionaries in India. And it is, the question arises, why? So it is clear that at that time, the Britishers were not ready to hurt us, our sentiments, okay? Because it will be a negative point for them. That is why they banned the arrival of Christian missionaries to India. But what I want, why I have explained you this, so that you can be able to understand that how the Christian religion came to India, as well as there was one provision of the Charter Act of 1813, I have explained you, that the sum of one lakh rupee was set aside for the purpose of developing the English education in India, okay? There is one more provision of this, and that provision was only this, that the Charter Act of 1813, okay, after the Charter Act of 1813, the company allowed licensed missionaries to India. That means the missionaries, those who have license, that means they have to register themselves first to the English East India Company, then only they would come, allowed to come to India for the purpose of spreading their religion. Okay, so when Christian missionaries came to India for the purpose of spreading the religion, that was the time when there was the establishment of lots of missionary schools took place. Today also, if you will talk about your city only, so there are so many missionaries school here. Missionary school means the convent school, the schools that are run by Christian communities, okay? So basically missionary schools were set up at that time after the Charter Act of 1813 to provide the moral education to the people of India. Okay, but after the revolt of 1857, since those missionary activities were hurting the sentiments of Indians, that was also the reason that why Indian people revolted against the British government. So after the revolt of 1857, the British government stopped direct support to missionaries. Once again, after the revolt of 1857, British government again stopped the direct support to missionaries because they do not want again a revolt like 1857 revolt, okay? So this was the reason that they allowed the missionary activities, but they do not want to hurt us. That is why they stop it also. Now let us move further, and here is the comparison between the traditional versus modern education system, okay? I have already explained you that what was the structure of the traditional, that is the education system of India in pre-colonial era, okay? Basically all of you are knowing that education system, all of you have known there was no school, no registers, no roll call, no attendance compulsory, okay? No such kind of buildings, no furnitures for the students, okay? One teacher only teach whole subjects. It was like that, okay? But how the education changed, that we will see. So when Britishers came to India, okay, they basically focused on higher education, okay? When the Woods Dispatch came to India, like you have seen that lots, three universities were set up in India, okay? So basically they focused on higher education only in the starting, okay? They focused on higher education only in the starting, but later on, okay? And dekho, they focused on the higher education, but they allowed the local pathshalas to function without much interference. That means Britishers only worked in the field of higher education, but local pathshalas were running like that only. But after some time, or after the revolt of 1857, the company decided, because the company decided that they are going to improve the vernacular education also. Companies decided that they have to improve the pathshalas also. Those pathshalas were running in vernacular languages, in the regional languages. So Britishers, for convincing us, Britishers decided that now they will also promote the Pathshalas. Okay, so they decided that how they are going to do this, how they will do this. So basically they have to order within the system. There should be one order, law and order. According to that only the schools will be run. Earlier these schools were running according to themselves only. The gurus or the pandits were only running the school. Okay, imposing routines, that means that child should be bound in routines according to this. So Pathshalas should be work in one routine. One routine should be followed, like morning time, okay, the timetables, the periods, the subjects, everything should be scheduled. Now establishing rules, there should be rules also for coming to school, how they have to come, how they have to go, okay, for discipline. So everything should be maintained, and for that purpose only, to checking that the schools are running properly or not, ensuring regular inspection. Okay, so they also appointed people for the regular inspection of this school. So let us understand that those who were the those people. Basically schools were running by the religious functionaries. Okay, so they appointed government pandits. Some of the pandits were appointed as government pandits. Okay, these pandits were the in charge of 4-5 schools in that particular area. Okay, whatever, suppose that the government appoint one pandit, and that pandit was responsible for taking care of the 4-5 schools in that particular area. Okay, what they have to do, what was their task? So basically they have to visit Pathshalas time to time. The pandits have to visit the Pathshalas time to time to check the standard of the teaching, that how is the teaching going on in the schools, as well as to check that the classes are running as per timetable. They have to also check that teachers are doing their duties properly and classes. So are you all able to understand that what was the condition like? Like those Pathshalas were becoming slowly, they were getting under the control of the Britishers. They have started establishing their control over the Britishers. Now the question arises, it is not necessary that every pandit or every guru have accepted the administration of the Britishers. Some of them have not accepted their administration. Some of them have said that now, no, we will run our schools or Pathshalas independently. Or some of them have willingly accepted. Now the Britishers said that the schools or the Pathshalas, those who were accept our administration, or those who will accept our whatever, okay, our administration, then only we will provide fund to that school. That means the gurus or pandits, those who were running their school independently without Britishers, so they were not provided with the fund. Okay, so this was the problem. Slowly, the schools or Pathshalas came under the supervision of the state governments. Okay, now the methods of the teaching also changed. The teaching was now to be based on textbook, and learning was to be tested. Now there is a provision of textbook. Now people started learning through textbook as well as their exam or final examination have also started taking place. Okay, earlier there was no provision of exams, but now exams have also been taking place. Okay, now students were asked to pay a regular fees. Earlier the system of education in India was that there was no fixed fees. Okay, students were allowed, the rich, if the parents of the students were rich, so they pay the fees according to that. If they were poor, so they were not allowed to pay the fees. Okay, basically, but in the British provision or under the British administration, the schools have allowed, or they have started asking to pay a regular and a fixed fees. Okay, like today the system of education is like that only, na? We have to pay the fees if we are learning in any school. Okay, and the fees is fixed for everyone. It is not divided on the basis of any kind. Okay, so basically the students have to pay a fixed fees, as well as they have to attend regular classes. Now the attendance is also compulsory in the school. They have to sit on a fixed place in the class, as well as the students have to also obey the rules. Okay, so it was like that only. The school system become like this. Okay, now there is one loss here also. When the provision of fixed regular fees started, it affected the poor people of India, the children of the peasant, artisan and craft person. They were affected negatively because they were not that rich to pay the regular fees of the school. So that is why their education, their students started lagging education. Okay. So there were some benefits also of the British education, and there were some demerits also. Okay. Now the question arises that when Britishers were introducing Western education in India, so don't you think that at that time there were some Indians? What was the point of view of the Indians at that time? Okay. What was the point of view of the Indians regarding the Western education? What some of the educationists of India, that means the people, those who were literate at that time, okay, what they were thinking of the Western education. So basically here also, people or the group of people were divided into two mindset. They were divided into two mindset. Basically one group believes that yes, Western education is good for us, and the second group believe that Western education is of no use. Okay, so here also Indian educationists were divided into two groups. The first group of some Indians felt that Western education would help modernize India. Some of the Indians believe that modern education will modernize us, a Western education will modernize, we will learn English. And yes, India was lagging behind in comparison to the European countries. India was not that developed. Okay. So basically, so what happened? They supported Western education, as well as they urged the Britishers, they requested to the Britishers to open more school, colleges and universities in India that are based on Western education. They are not wrong here. We cannot say that they are wrong. They are right, because it was very necessary for us to get the Western education. They were not saying this, that if we are adopting the Western education, that means we have to not follow our culture. Okay, we have to feel proud for our country only, but Western education is also necessary for us. The second group believed that there were Indians who reacted against the Western education, because they believed that Western education is creating inferiority between the youth. Okay, inferiority related to their own country. That means that with the introduction of the Western education in India, the Indian people have started inculcating the feeling that Western or Europe is superior than India. Okay, they were losing the pride that they were having in their country. They were losing the respect for their country with the introduction of Western education, and that is why they were against the Western education. So basically in this chapter, we will learn about the two very famous people, that what was their view regarding the Western education in India. The first is Mahatma Gandhi and the other is Rabindranath Tagore. Okay, so let us see here. What was the opinion of Mahatma Gandhi regarding the Western education? Mahatma Gandhi believed that colonial education created a sense of inferiority in the minds of Indian people. Inferiority means to think that someone is better than you, or you are inferior than that person. Okay, so basically according to Mahatma Gandhi, that the Western education is inculcating the feeling in the Indians that Indians are less than Britain. Okay, it made us see Western civilization superior. We have started thinking that the Western lifestyle, the Western food, Western thinking is better than Indians. Okay, and this is destroying the pride we had in our own culture, and that is why we are losing faith, or we are losing pride in our own country. Okay, Mahatma Gandhi wanted an education that could help Indians recover their sense of dignity and self-respect. So according to Mahatma Gandhi, he wanted a type of education that create self-respect into the Indian humans, and that create a pride for their nation. Okay, Mahatma Gandhi believed that, he strongly felt that Indian language ought to be the medium of teaching. He believed that English should not be the medium of teaching to the Indian people. It should be their language only, our language only, our vernacular language, or Hindi. Okay. Now, according to Mahatma Gandhi said that Western education lacked experience, real life experience, as well as they do not impart practical education. Students, from the starting, we are telling this, that Western education was the practical education. But how Mahatma Gandhi said that it was not practical education? Because according to Mahatma Gandhi, that reading and writing is not education. If you learn to read and write, it is just literacy. And he believed that Western education only teach us, or with Western education, we are only learning to read and write, okay? There is nothing like practical. We are not learning how to live our life. We are not learning real life experiences with Western education, okay? So that is why he is saying that everyone should learn the work. He believed that every person has to learn to do something like craft, pottery, weaving, okay? So that they can earn their livelihood with the help of that particular craft. So he basically believed that education doesn't mean only reading and writing. Education means the overall development or all-round development of a person. And he suggested that every person should be good in craft, technical skill, as well as literacy and education. Okay, that means education means all-round development, that a person should know reading also, writing also, a person should know various skills also. Okay, so basically Gandhiji believed that education means the mixture, okay, or everything, that the integration of skill, craft, or literacy, okay? And he gave the name to this scheme as Nai Taleem. Nai Taleem was given by Mahatma Gandhi only. And what was Nai Taleem? Nai Taleem was the scheme of education, or Nai Taleem was a program started by Mahatma Gandhi. Okay, according to Mahatma Gandhi, a student has to be gain the knowledge of writing as well as reading also, and he or she should be perfect in any skill or in any technology so that he can also earn his or her livelihood, okay? So basically it was like that. This was the opinion of Mahatma Gandhi, and he strongly opposed the Western education in India. Now we are going to learn about Tagore, okay? Tagore, Abode of Peace. Now students, Abode of Peace matlab, Tagore is credited, okay? Tagore is credited to establish a school, okay, to set up a school in Calcutta. Its name was Shanti Niketan. This Abode of Peace means Shanti Niketan, means the place where there is peace. Now students, if I'll talk about Rabindranath Tagore, so let us talk about his real experience, what he experienced in life. When Rabindranath Tagore was a child, he never liked to go to school. He was just like you all. He never liked to go to school because he feel that school is like a jail, okay, where they have to sit at one place, okay, where they have to follow the rules, okay. So basically he feel like that the school is like a prison. He believed that he is not free in the school to do whatever he want to do, okay? He had to sit at a place, he had to learn whatever teachers are teaching. He is not free, his mind is not free, okay? So he hated school from his childhood only. And at that time only, Rabindranath Tagore dreamt that one day he will establish one school, which is, that school was not be like this, the traditional school. So yes, Rabindranath Tagore set up a school, okay, named Shanti Niketan, and that school was the school where the children were free to do whatever they want to do. So basically he built the school 100 kilometer away from Calcutta, Shanti Niketan, in 1901. Okay, according to him, here a child was happy, free and creative. The child was free, there was no provision of classrooms, okay? The child was free. Child was free to use his creative mind as well as to use his curiosity, okay? The studies was not for the only the competitions. So this was the belief of Rabindranath Tagore. Rabindranath Tagore wanted to set up a school where children were encouraged to study in a natural environment, okay? So according to him, childhood was the time of self-learning. According to Rabindranath Tagore, he believed that childhood is the time when children learn by themselves only, and children should not be restricted to a classroom only. Okay, so it was the belief of Rabindranath Tagore, and basically, like Mahatma Gandhi totally opposed the Western education, but Rabindranath Tagore said that the education should be the mixture. Okay, whatever best is there in the Western education, we have to adopt it. And whatever best is there in the Indian education, we have to adopt that also. So according to Rabindranath Tagore, education should be the integration of Western education also and Indian education also. We have to take the best part of both the educations. Okay, he basically said that teacher should understand the child and help him or her in developing curiosity. A teacher should always encourage the students for curiosity. That means for having curiosity that why this thing happens, how this thing is happening, okay, all these things. Now, Tagore wanted to combine best elements of both the education systems. So, I hope it is clear to you that how both of them were thinking. Basically, Mahatma Gandhi totally opposed the Western education. But Rabindranath Tagore accepted the integration or the combination of the best part of both the education system. So this was the last topic of this chapter. I hope all of you are able to understand this chapter well. Please read the book, watch the video, come for the Zoom classes, and I hope whatever queries you are having after watching the video, you can ask in the Zoom classes. So this is all for today, students.